Let us worship.
Hey, everybody. So I'm going to start off with a hymn. I'm going to start off with Amazing Grace.
An important part of the wonderful inauguration ceremonies that took part in this last week. Thank you, David. We would like to extend an especially warm welcome to those who are here for the first time, and we are so glad you found us. Our greeter today, Marilyn, is dropping our connection card into the chat box if you'd like to complete that and have a way to connect even further with our community. This caring, supportive community has a pastoral care committee who works closely with our minister to provide support, care, and a listening ear. Please fill out the pastoral care card being dropped in the chat box by Marilyn if you would like that care team or Reverend Laura to reach out to you. Please do use this resource at this difficult time. There's also a link on the website that's always there. Our online services are intergenerational, and we have a religious exploration program whose director, as I mentioned, Rebecca Britt, is happy to hear from you, and her email is now going in the chat box, and she will be giving us a story in just a few minutes as well. There's a lot happening here at South Valley, and the Happenings weekly newsletter is a great, concise, up-to-the-minute way to know what is going on and stay connected. So Lori Quigley is willing to have you and wants you to connect with her through her email that is now in the chat box if you would like to get that newsletter and you don't already get it. And then there's also an active Facebook page, and there is an event calendar on our website. So please do make the chance and opportunity to connect in with this wonderful community. One announcement is that we are changing how we give at South Valley. So starting next month, we'll begin using Breeze, which we're gonna use for a bunch of things. Maureen got on, showed me all the cool things that are on there. If you haven't gone on and looked and signed up, it's gonna be a great way, another way for us all to connect. So next month, we will stop using PayPal and Givelify. And so thereby streamlining and simplifying to a single payment system and using Breeze. You'll be able to give on Sundays, but you'll also easily be able to track your giving history on that Breeze program. So if you haven't already, set up that profile there. And let's see, if you want help setting it up, Lori Quigley, whose email is in the chat box, or Cindy Martin, our administrator, would be very happy to help you get that set up. And now we're going to take a moment and unmute if you would like and join in on saying hello to one another and then having the chalice lighting words that we'll say together. So stay unmuted for both those things. So go for it. Hello, everyone.
Ooh, hello.
Good morning, everybody. Hello from Sandy.
Hello.
Hi, Janice. Hi, Dana.
Hi.
Hi.
Good to be with you all.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Hi, Johnny. For your great.
Morning.
Wonderful to hear all your voices and see your dear faces. If you have a candle or a chalice, feel free to
Brenda, you're muted.
Looks like we muted everybody. Sorry. Go ahead and unmute, and we'll do the chalice together as well. And the chalice lighting words will be in the chat box. We light this chalice for the warmth for the light of truth
and for the energy of action.
Doesn't work.
Good morning. I'm Dana Wright, and I am a member of the Board of Trustees here at South Valley UU Society. My pronouns are she and her. Come, come, whoever you are welcome here, no matter your age, your size, the color of your eyes, your hair, your skin, you are welcome here. No matter your gender, whom you love, how you speak, or whatever your abilities, you are welcome here. You are welcome here whether you come with laughter in your heart or tears in your eyes. You are welcome here. No matter what you have experienced in the past, no matter what awaits you in the future, you are welcome here. Whether you believe in God all of the time or some of the time, or none of the time, you are welcome here. This is a community of open minds, loving hearts, and willing hands. You are welcome here at South Valley Unitarian Universalist Society.
It is good to be together this morning. I'm the Reverend Laura Young, and my pronouns are she and her. As we gather into this sacred space that we co-create each week in our online format, I invite you just to settle a little deeper into your chair, into your couch, on the floor, and find your grounding. And just breathe into this communal space and know that our goodness, while we are separate from each other, is not limited, that we can indeed reach across the electronic waves and reach out and be present with one another. As I've been preparing for service this week, I've been reading a lot of poetry, and I came across a description of how poetry might be used in our lives. And they suggested three different ways of approaching poetry. One is a way to ground yourself in the day, to use poetry as a way to awaken you and to ground you in your day. Secondly, to use poetry as a companion throughout your day so that it carries you through those moments for whatever it is that's unfolding in your life and reminding you that there is a still and small and quiet space inside of each of us that can be connected to at any time. And lastly, to use poetry as a talisman of sorts, as that thread that pulls you when you are off kilter or off center back to that place of groundedness and centeredness. And from there, to share that poetry with one another as a way to create that space for another. So our poetry reading this morning to open our worship is written by John Fox, and it's entitled, When Someone Listens Deeply to You. When someone deeply listens to you, it is like holding out a dented cup you've had since childhood and watching it fill up with cold, fresh water. When it balances on top of the brim, you are understood. When it overflows and touches your skin, you are loved. When someone deeply listens to you, the room where you stay starts a new life, and the place where you wrote your first poem begins to glow in your mind's eye. It is as if gold has been discovered. When someone deeply listens to you, your bare feet are on the earth, and a beloved land that seemed distant is now at home within you. So may you be well, and may this time together be a blessing upon your life. We're going to be changing it up a little bit this morning and enjoying a little bit of Beatles with David Lane. He's going to lead us not in our gathering hymn, but in a song that is very dear and familiar to many of us, Here Comes the Sun. Sing along as you can, hum along if you wish.
Here comes the sun, here comes the sun, and I say, it's all right. Little darling, in the long, cold, lonely winter, little darling, it feels like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, here comes the sun, and I say, little darling, smiles returning to the faces. Little darling, it feels like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun, and I say, it's all right. Ice is slowly melting. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been clear. Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun, and I say, it's all right.
For Time for All Ages. Well, it's not just me. I'm here with Porpoise and Fish, who have a story to tell you. And I have to warn you, I haven't been able to tell this story without laughing. So feel free to just laugh along. This is the Tri-Day. Porpoise and Fish had gotten kicked out of the home office. Rebecca was doing something called deep cleaning, which they surmised was very brave and hard thing to do, even if they weren't sure why. I think it's time for our try day, Fish said. We should take advantage of our time out of the office and try new things. I'm going to find the raspberry jam, Porpoise decided. Fish laughed. That's upstairs in the kitchen. You can't do that. You're being ridiculous. I can try, Porpoise said. It is try day after all. Well, Fish had plans of his own. He first tried to print his screenplay. He had tried very hard to write it, and he was ready to send it around. But no matter how many laptop buttons he clicked, nothing happened. Ladybug appeared. Can I help you print? She asked. No, Fish sighed. I already tried. And he went on his way. Porpoise had swum up and down the shores of California, but they never climbed stairs. They threw themselves at the bottom step over and over, but nothing. Psst, Porpoise heard. They looked up and saw a dolphin. Dolphin was a friend of theirs. They were an upstairs sea creature and the one who had told them about the strawberry jam. Use your back fin to propel you up the steps, Dolphin said. It'll work, try again. Amazing! Porpoise's fin shot them right up next to Dolphin. What next? Porpoise asked. I don't know, Dolphin admitted. I've been trying to get up, but I'm a little stuck. Meanwhile, Fish was working on making hot chocolate. If Porpoise could have raspberry jam, why couldn't he have hot chocolate? He thought he could just microwave the hot chocolate jar he'd seen so many times, but he couldn't, and he didn't have any of the things he needed to get it done. Birthday Cat appeared. Hey, I want hot chocolate too. I have the stuff to make it. Good for you, Fish grumbled, and he swam away. While Porpoise and Dolphin debated how to get up the last steps, Sea Lion easily wiggled down the top few steps. Hey, fellas, he called down. Coming up for some raspberry jam? Excuse me. We're trying, Dolphin said. What should we do? Just wiggle up, Sea Lion said. Just wiggle? Porpoise asked. We'll be as fast as you? Oh, nah, Sea Lion said. It'll take a good while since it's your first time, but you'll get up here eventually. And after a bunch more times, it'll be fast and easy. They wiggled and they wiggled and they wiggled until it felt like hours went by. But then, all at once, there was nothing to wiggle. There was nowhere else to wiggle because they were at the top of the stairs. Amazing! They were upstairs, so close to the raspberry jam. And Porpoise was with two upstairs sea creatures who could show them to the kitchen. Next time, they'd be able to find it on their own. Worth all the trying? Sea Lion asked. Oh, yes, Porpoise said. Hey, do you think I could take this downstairs? It'd be hard work, Sea Lion said. That's okay, Porpoise said. I'll give it a shot. Downstairs in the office, Fish decided to do something he didn't need to try to do and take a nap. His feelings about trying were all bad and he needed a rest. Porpoise had made the long journey downstairs and hurried to their resting spot. Fish, Fish, wake up! I got raspberry jam. I did it. Fish felt doubtful. You did it all by yourself? Well, no, but it was never a rule we had to try alone. Fish admitted, I didn't do anything I tried. I'm no good at new things. Porpoise disagreed. We can make tomorrow another try day, and I'll be your helper then. But right now I need you to be my helper. I'm gonna have to need your help to get back up the stairs to return the raspberry jam. Before the people noticed, we took their most prized possession. What? Fish squawked. I don't know how to climb the steps. That's okay, Porpoise said. You will soon. The end. Thank you.
This community, our church, and its many ministries are only made possible by the gifts you give of your time, your talent, and your treasure. Many of you pledge monthly to support our work, and for that we're very grateful. Your gifts help ensure we're able to live our values of love and justice in the world beyond us. Part of our ministry at South Valley includes sharing our Sunday worship offerings with a charitable organization that aligns with our principles and values. Your gift today supports the work of South Valley and of Crossroads Urban Center's Emergency Fund. This fund is helping those struggling to meet rent and utility payments during these difficult economic times. Crossroads is a nonprofit, multi-faith, community-based economic justice organization established in 1966, been around quite a while helping people. A grassroots organization that assists low-income Utahns, those with disabilities, and people of color to meet basic survival needs and address essential issues regarding stability and quality of life. Please give generously. And we do at this time still use Giblify to collect online donations during worship. So you're invited to use that link that Marilyn has dropped into the chat box or go to the phone and download the app. And thank you for your generosity and dedication to justice and love. The offering words are now in the chat box. You are invited to say these words along with me at home. We are this church. We are its hands, its heart, its voice. Together, we share the wealth of this community and sustain it with our gifts.
There's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no country. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. No religion. The people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you will join us. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people. All say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you will join us and the world will live as one.
Thank you, David. Your words and your music are always such a balm to the weary heart. For all that we have received and all we have found the courage to give, may we be truly grateful. May these gifts be a blessing upon South Valley and upon Crossroads Urban Ministry. I invite you now to settle into a time of quiet reflection, meditation, or prayer. Mary Oliver once wrote that the real prayers are not the words, but the attention that comes first. So may this time of quiet spaciousness be one of a burnishing and growing sense of attention within. Let us be quiet with one another. Spirit of life, may you wend your way among us this morning, across the white, white snow that has freshly fallen upon our mountains, in the rivers that continue to flow ever colder, in the wind that rustles, and in the birds that sing. May we find what we need most by just looking out the window, reaching across any divides or divisions to that which is true and that which is grounded, that which is loving and compassionate, joyful and at peace. May our weary hearts come to a resting stillness, and may our eyes seek out and touch those that need our presence today, and spread that warmth that is this community across, above, and beyond any limitations of technology. And remind us that goodness is found in our togetherness. May all be well. May it be so. And amen.
Might have seen quotes at the beginning of the service before we began from Carol Dweck. Quotes like, "This is hard, this is fun." These quotes come from the idea of a growth mindset, the idea that we can approach our lives with the belief that our capacity and our talents can be improved and enlarged over time. And when Carol Dweck created this and worked with education and educators, an example of a growth mindset is if a worksheet is given to a student and they're able to do it quickly with no trouble, that the educator would say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't give you something more challenging. Let's try another worksheet. And that that is, in fact, our effort and our purpose is to be stretching and to be growing. This is in opposition to a fixed mindset that I have only a certain amount of intelligence or only a certain amount of capacity. And many studies have been done on the amazing effects of approaching things with a growth mindset and what humans can grow to do. So if you want to think about our comfort zone that we talk about a lot, right? So if the comfort zone is here, then if there's a bigger circle around that, which is the challenge zone. And so between where the comfort zone ends and where this circle is, are many kinds of activities that could challenge us, right? And then out further would be perhaps a very risky zone, an OMG zone, okay? So it's great to be in the challenge zone. So for instance, this rubber band is not doing a whole lot as it just wiggles here comfortably. It's not really being able to accomplish much. But if it's a little bit tense, it's going to hold things together, a newspaper rolled up or whatever it's meant to hold. If it's like this, it's perhaps going to burst at any moment. That's kind of risky and perhaps not its best purpose or use. So finding that challenge zone is good for us too. I love the Father Brown mystery series. I don't know if anyone else reads those. They were created by G.K. Chesterton, and he lived from 1874 to 1936 in England. And he was raised in a Unitarian family, but he did convert to Catholicism later in his life. He was 6'4" tall, weighed 280 pounds, wore a cape, had a cigar hanging out of his lips at every moment, used a sword stick, which means there was a knife inside this walking stick, ready for anything, and was, as you can tell, quite the character. He was a philosopher. He wrote many, many things besides the Father Brown mystery series. It was said of him that whenever possible, Chesterton made his points with popular sayings and proverbs and allegories, first carefully turning them inside out. For the last 4 to 5 years of his life, he had a popular weekly radio show and he had script, but he usually went off script and innovated and improvised. And that was very unusual for that time in early radio. He is purported to have said, anything worth doing is worth doing badly. And I think that's the ultimate growth mindset quote, because the first time we try something, it probably isn't gonna go that great. But if it's worth doing, it's worth going through that. I think of my regrets in my life. I think of the times when I didn't challenge myself more than times I took on a challenge and maybe didn't do it as great as I wished, or when I misplaced priorities. I think of how many years went by with me being angry and resentful of my birth family over their reactions to my being lesbian. And how when I finally decided to let go, we could begin to build our relationships again. Or at my last few years of work were especially challenging. I tried to stay in the growth mindset, but a lot of times I slipped into thinking I was in the excessive risk zone. And I brought a lot of anxiety and upset home with me. This last year has been a challenge for all of us. And I have wished I could stay in the place where I see it as a challenge and not excessive risk. So I keep trying. I think it's a tool for our knapsack to change that perception of I'm in the challenge zone. There's times when it might be excessive risk, I need to know that, but my perception affects how I see, right? In one of my writing classes, we were asked to choose 3 action verbs that resonated with us and take those and build on them to recognize our purpose and claim it. And I chose ignite, awaken, and learn. And I wrote, ignite action in myself and others, awaken to the joy that's available when we use our talents and skills to our full potential, and continuously learn while on this earth. I invite you to try that exercise, and I invite you to check out Father Brown.
Thank you, Brenda, for your kindness and your compassion towards self and others. So in the beginning, there was a sudden and eerie silence that descended upon the land. The skies were free of airplanes, and the streets were empty of cars, buses, and trucks. All that was left were the pedestrians. You remember that? Last March, those early weeks after the initial shock and adjustment, how quiet it was, how oddly quiet it was. And yet simultaneously alongside that, there was a sudden shift in social media. Our social media accounts shifted from posts about dinners out and vacations enjoyed to how to best capitalize on this supposedly newfound freedom. Back then, we imagined it would just be a few short weeks before rebounding to normal. And thus, that was the perfect time to start picking up a new instrument, finishing our novel, or at least baking bread from scratch. And while many of these suggestions were well-intentioned and many of them were good forms of coping, it was also a lot of pressure. For instead of just coping with the stress as best we could in a situation for which we had no preparation and very little experience, we were expected to do more than just grapple and survive. We were expected to immediately thrive and then post about it on Facebook. And as the saying goes, that turned out to be a rather tall order. A year into the pandemic, I noticed that most of us have yet to finish that novel, the one we started reading, not the one we intended to write. And right now I notice that there is a persistent malaise among us, as if that rubber band that Brenda just mentioned is overstretched and tired of being stretched out. We're a bit tired, and we're tired of being tired. And that means we are susceptible to messages, both internal and external, that suggest that possibly the real reason that we feel so terrible is not just because we are enduring an extended season of isolation and despair resulting from the pandemic and increased political division, but because we are perhaps potentially lazy or in danger of becoming so if we do not keep a watchful eye on ourselves. And I hear it from friends and from family and from many of you, this underlying frustration with self for the ways in which the days meld into one another, and it just seems impossible to get done what we normally might have been able to accomplish. This frustration is real, but the conclusion that somehow we are inherently lazy is utterly and completely false. Laziness does not exist. Laziness does not exist. This is a truth. And it also happens to be the title of a new book by Devin Price. Devin Price, the author, grew up in Appalachia to parents who did not have university educations, but very much wanted their child to do so. And so Devin did. They worked hard and achieved as much and as fast and as rapidly and as difficultly as they could, even earning their PhD at age 25. And then they developed a fever that would not go away for more than a year. It became clear to Devin at that point that the only solution was to start doing less. So they did. And the result is their new book, which argues persuasively that this accusation of laziness, which we mostly hurl at ourselves, is a complete and utter falsehood. Devin Price proposes that there are three tenets or elements to this myth of laziness that are embedded in our culture and to which we may be more susceptible to in this time of isolation. The first is that we have a tendency to define our worth based on our productivity. We have a tendency to define our worth based on our productivity. And while it is all well and good to be productive, and it is actually healthy because we have legitimate needs to be productive, to be contributing members of society, to be able to share our time and our talent with others, because it brings us joy and fulfillment. The shadow side, which is all too easily activated by social media, is a space where our inner critics may get the best of us. And instead of turning us toward self-care, it can turn us towards habits of negativity, where feelings of shame and guilt, regret, and suppressed grief can overwhelm us and make our coping more strife and more challenging. Secondly, Devin Price persuades us that we have been trained by our society to distrust our own exhaustion, to discount our own needs for comfort or care, connection or rest. And this is where social media brag posts can really get under our skin. For we can feel at times that just resting or doing less, or maybe even nothing at all, is a form of cheating. And the third tenet of this myth, this falsehood that we are inherently lazy from Devin Price, is that we live with this persistent feeling in our culture that there's just something more that we can always be doing. Not just work, but also things like activism or exercise or just showing up for each other. And these three tenets, always active in our cultural milieu and embedded in our psyches, are exacerbated right now by the pandemic, by our isolation, and of course by social media, which is both an outlet and a source that we need to be protective of ourselves around. This chronic myth of laziness is flaring up, I suspect, in our culture, as it's been this year, and it seems it will be yet another half a year before we might be able to resume some of those more typical activities of daily living. So I think now would be as good a time as ever to begin to let go again of that fear of laziness and turn instead to the practice of wholeness, making the leap from laziness and fearfulness of laziness to that practice of wholeness requires letting go of that which we do not need, packing light, if you will, by shedding those habits that we do not need. Laziness or fear of it does not belong in this knapsack that we're going to carry for the next 6 to 9 months together in community. And neither does shoulda or coulda or woulda belong in our knapsack. So chuck them out, if you will, right now. Just open up that proverbial knapsack and pull out the shoulds and the woulds and the coulds and that fear of laziness and make some space in that knapsack for yourself. And here's some three things that you might want to put back in for your consideration. One tool you might put in that knapsack as we head into the next phase of this journey is an increased sense of social media hygiene, practicing good social media hygiene, which could include having limits on how often or how much you check your social media posts, or perhaps committing to a weekly social media fast or a Sabbath of sorts. I do this on Mondays. I have it written on my daily, weekly checklist. And on Mondays, it says, I'm not allowed to check Facebook, and I'm not allowed to check the news, and I'm not allowed to check my email. And I'm successful about 50% of the time. So I encourage you to try this next week to maybe see if you can go even just for a couple of hours without checking your social media posts. When we do this sort of cleansing behavior, this hygiene around social media, it allows us to settle into our actual life and our real relationships rather than other people's posts about what they want us to know about their lives. Remember that social media is not our real life. It is a repository of what we want other people to know about our life. A second tool to consider putting inside your knapsack is a simple practice that I call grief sitting. There's a lot of suppressed grief in our culture right now. Our sadness is real about the life events that we have missed or deferred, the loss of physical touch and connection, freedom of movement, and the real loss of family and friends to this pandemic and to the other causes of death. And much of this goes ungrieved. And this unresolved and this unfelt grief can leave us feeling a bit out of sorts, frustrated, exhausted, even frenetic. And one way you might consider managing this is what is a 30-second grief sit. You would simply sit down in a quiet space, breathe, and just notice for 30 seconds what you're actually feeling without judgment and without analysis. It may take you a few times of trying this before anything happens. And I would encourage you not to overthink this if you give it a try. And I certainly do not want you to try and practice this 10 times a day for 2 minutes each. It is 30 seconds only, once a day, or maybe every 8 days if that's how often you can remember to do it. And key to the grief sit is don't tell anyone else about your plans for greater enlightenment. And don't tell anyone what happens or doesn't happen along the way. Just give yourself this 30 seconds, just for yourself, just as that little gift along the way. And lastly, the third tool for your knapsack this week is to try and break the habit of comparing your suffering to that of another. There is always someone who has it better or worse than you do. And yes, there are different levels of privilege and access to care that make surviving this time more or less possible. And those are important to pay attention to. But paying attention to disparities is not the same as minimizing our own suffering or that of another and a form of false courage or bravery or stoicism. In fact, minimizing or lessening or comparing our suffering to another usually forces it further away from us and again contributes to that suppressed grief. If you want to help another person, sit with your own grief and do not minimize or diminish it, but allow it just to be what it is so that it may pass on through. And come to church, because today there might be someone in that Zoom room that needs to see you. Yes, you and you and you. Someone in this room might need to see you today. So keep showing up. Our faith tradition as Unitarian Universalists is rich in both our history and our principles for how to navigate these uncertain and difficult times with grace and resilience. We are a community based on the inherent worth and the dignity of all people. And while we often assume that means others, it also includes ourselves. You and I and we share dignity and worth as both an individual endowment and as a set of collective responsibilities that bind us together to one another and to this living tradition as Unitarian Universalists. As we go forth into these next days and weeks, I encourage you to observe both yourself and others doing this work in little bits and in bigger leaps, breathing and doing and coping as best we can right now. As best we can, so that when we emerge from this time, which is a time out of time, we may return to one another with a sense of being intact and being whole. Be strong and be brave, but remember that strength and bravery and courage come from your vulnerability, not from your stoicism. So reach out this week. Be kind to yourself and be present to yourself. And perhaps look into our Zoom room this morning and notice someone that you haven't noticed in a while. And maybe give them a little wave or a little message in the chat box or even an email or a phone call or just a little hello in the social hour today. And by that, weave together this community in love and kindness, compassion, and resilience. Be well, and amen. From this space of quietness, let us sing together. Our final hymn this morning is Morning Has Broken. And David Lane will lead us in this hymn.
Thank you, Reverend Laura. Those words really resonated with me. I find that I need to make space for boredom, of all things. I know that sounds weird, but... Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world. Sweet the rains new fall, thank you.
So beautiful, David. Thank you. We're going to extinguish our chalice. The words will be in the chat box. Please go ahead and unmute, and we will say these together.
We extinguish this chalice,
but not the warmth of warmth of love, light of truth, or the energy of action. Hold each other in our hearts and meet again.
Thank you.
Hi.
Love. Nothing you can do that can't be done. Nothing you can sing that can't be sung. Nothing you can say but learn how to play the game. It's easy. Nothing you can make that can't be made. Nothing you can say that can't be saved. Nothing you can do but learn about you in time. It's easy. Is all you need. Nothing you can know that isn't known. Nothing you can see that isn't shown. Nothing you can be that isn't where you're meant to be. It's easy. And all you need is love. All you need. Love. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love is all you need. All you need is love. All together now. All you need is love. Everybody now. And all you need is love. Love. Love is all you need.
Time of worship is coming to its conclusion and its close, but our time of service to one another is yet beginning. May your knapsack be more spacious this week, and may you remember that its straps that are on your back are love, and that you are never lost as long as you remember that there is more love in the world always available at the bottom of your feet. Mary Oliver writes in the end of that prayer that I mentioned this morning in meditation, she writes that the little hawk leaned sideways and tilted and rode the wind. So may your hearts this week find that uplift, that current of wind, and may you soar to new places, to challenge when it calls you, and to rest and deep recovery when that is what you need as well. And the space between those two is that deep discernment and that love surrounds you in every moment. May you be well, be good to yourselves and to one another, and we'll see you in a few minutes for our social time. Blessings on your day.